Thank you. Good morning. We welcome you this morning to Chapelgate in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We believe he's here amid the chaos and the sound and the joy. And we pray that he'll enter into your hearts and lives where you are, whatever's going on, and minister his grace and peace to you. A few announcements to make before we begin worship. First of all, we are participating in a school supplies drive actually for two areas. One is benefits the Howard County schools, and the other, the Edison School Brems campus in Baltimore City. If you were here with us a few years ago, one of our members, Joyce Rain, alerted us to needs at the Brems School in Baltimore, and we participated in a book drive. And now we're participating in helping them with uniforms and other supplies. And let me just read the instructions to you. If you want to be involved with the go to either the Kindness Pantry, which benefits Howard County Schools, so I guess you get online and Google Kindness Pantry, or make donations to the Edison School Brems campus through Amazon. And you could get on our website or our app and learn how to do that. But we just love the opportunity to be able to serve the broader communities we live in and near. The Lord's blessed our church and our people, and this is just a great opportunity. We hope that you will participate. We will. We are thankful that the Academy has sent and they've returned from, I think they're back. Are they back? Yeah, from Costa Rica. They're on a missions trip. You can find a few pics that are right in front of you. 13 students, along with some staff, went there and served as they have through the years. They were able to build or deliver 30 beds and sheets and blankets to children and family. And they also delivered food bags and spent time praying with each family, which was really wonderful. And we would be able to announce to you that team from Honduras is back. We had about 17 go to Honduras from our high school with chaperones, but they're stuck in Miami, which just breaks my heart. But anyways, pray for them. Their flight was delayed in Honduras, and they weren't able to get out of Miami. And regardless of where you get stuck, it's unsettling and a real pain. Thank you.
We're gathered here as a community to worship. And before we sing this first song, I just want to read a passage from Philippians 2. This is what it says. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is all hail. Yeah, it's all hail the power of Jesus' name. You think I know that by now? Would you stand and sing with us?
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown. Thank you. my God is the theme of my song, the joy of my heart and the boast of my tongue. Thy free grace alone, from the first to the last, hath won my affection, bound my soul fast. Without thy sweet mercy, I could not live here. Sin would reduce me to utter despair. But through thy free goodness, my spirit's revived. And he that first made me still keeps me alive. Thy mercy is more than a match for my heart, which wonders to feel its own hardness depart. Dissolved by thy goodness, I fall to the ground and weep for the praise of the mercy I found. Goodness I own in the covenant love of thy crucified Son. All praise to the Spirit whose whisper divine seals mercy and pardon and righteousness mine. All praise to the Spirit whose whisper divine seals mercy and pardon righteousness mine. Alleluia.
Good morning. My name is Patrick, and I'm so thankful this morning to be able to welcome up some of our missionary friends. I'm going to invite Dan Kramer to join me up here. He's going to share a little bit about the ministry that he's a part of. But before I do that, I just want to say it's just a beautiful reminder, even this morning, as we are coming out of that season of COVID, that God is working all over the world. It seems like the past few weeks, we've had all of these beautiful reminders with the Costa Rica team, the Johnny and Friends team, and the Honduras team, that there's stuff happening all over the world. And we're having our missionaries come back. We had the Coxes a few weeks ago, and they're here this morning. We've got, you know, the Culbertsons came. And this morning, we have Dan and his family who are here with us. Would you all stand just so that we could recognize you all this morning? Dan is a son of this church. He was sent out on the mission field, 20 years ago, just
yeah,
about?
Yeah.
Dan was first sent out with crew to Orlando, Florida, to work with what was formerly called Campus Crusade, and now he is working with the Jesus Film Project in Thailand. Dan, why don't you tell us a little bit about what you're doing and what God is doing in your ministry there in Thailand?
Thanks, Patrick, and thank you so much to the church for those 20 years of praying for us and helping us along with the financial support as well. We're really grateful, and it's great to be back here at home at Chapelgate. But we have been in Thailand for about 5 years now with the Jesus Film Project, and the Jesus Film is a movie that was made back in 1979. It tells the story of Jesus from the Gospel of Luke, and it's a really straightforward documentary style. Every word that Jesus speaks in that movie is straight from Scripture. And some of what we do there is to continue to get the Jesus Film translated and dubbed into more languages. Right now, we are right on the cusp of 2,000 languages that have already been dubbed, the most translated movie in the world. And God is still continuing to use this movie because it's reaching people in their heart language and because it's the Word of God. And so I'm able to help train people in how to do more of these dubbings to get it into more languages. I'm also able to help train and equip pastors and other missionaries in that region in Southeast Asia to use the tools that we already have. To show the Jesus Film, I'm able to help provide projectors. Some of them are solar powered so that people can take the Jesus Film to some of the most remote parts of the world. I have a picture here of a couple of guys that I like to call Charles and Timothy for security. That's not their real names. They came to Thailand for a conference, and I was able to give them each this backpack. And in the backpack, there's a solar panel, and there's a small projector and a speaker. And they're able to take this equipment to some of the most remote parts of the world. They live in a country that's very isolated from the rest of the world, a mountainous country. And they are going to take their backpacks, and they're going to drive to where the road ends, and then they're going to walk from village to village. They said it takes about a day to walk from each village to the next. And at night, they're going to sleep outside, and they're just going to wrap a cloak around them, a robe, and then the next day, they'll go to the next place. They'll show the Jesus Film, and they'll help plant new churches and train and equip other church planters with what they're doing.
Dan, what has God done that's good in your mind that you've, you know, experienced in the last couple of years working there in Thailand?
Yeah, so I think some of what I already mentioned, we're able to equip church planters with tools that will help them do their job better. You know, I can't go to these mountain villages and show the Jesus Film and equip and disciple people, but people like Charles and Timothy can do that. And to see the Jesus Film continue to go out into more and more languages, the idea of having a movie in your own language is so important to people who grow up speaking one language, and then they learn another one in school, and maybe they've learned three or four other languages as well. But the one that they connect to the most is their heart language. So to continue to have this film, Jesus, in more and more of those heart languages allows more and more people to connect with Jesus in the deepest way that they can.
Yeah, that's really important and really vital. It sounds like you're really equipping church planters, you know, to do the work in their places, which is really, really important. You know, the last 3 years for all of us all over the world have been incredibly difficult. What's been hard for you guys over in Thailand?
Yeah, definitely COVID has had its challenges. We could have left and come back to America, but if we did that, it would be very difficult for us to go back into Thailand during most of the last 3 years. Now the borders are more open. We're able to get back into the country without a quarantine, so we're grateful for that. So COVID has certainly been a challenge, and also just the community there. We're always praying for deeper community. There's a lot of missionaries there, a lot of expats living in Chiang Mai, Thailand, our city in the north. But it's very transient, and it's difficult to form deeper relationships with some of those people. So those are some of the challenges that our family has had.
Yeah. Well, how can we pray for you and your ministry, including that, obviously?
Yes. Yeah, continue to pray for that. And then our visas, you probably hear this from a lot of missionaries. We're always praying for our visas. We just applied for a new type of visa about 2 weeks ago, and Lord willing, we are hoping to receive those within the next 2 to 3 weeks, because we're hoping to go back to Thailand in the beginning of August. So pray that those would be approved and come in.
Okay. Well, before I pray, if you'd like to talk to Dan or Tawny and their family, they'll be at the table out in the lobby. If you're watching online and you want to know more about the Jesus Film Project, you can go to jesusfilm.org. And you'll find out more information about how God is using this film all over the world to reach people. In addition, we support 50 plus missionaries here at our church, and we do it all through your generous gifts. You can find out how to give towards mission by going to chapelgate.org/missions. Can I pray for you? Father, thank you for the calling you've placed on Dan, on Tawny, on their family, Lord, for calling them to serve in Chiang Mai, Thailand, Lord. I thank you that you're with them. And Lord, I would pray that you would raise up around them a community of people to walk alongside them, to encourage them and challenge them in the hope of the gospel. And that, Lord, that you would do that out of the abundance of your grace and mercy to them through Jesus, who gave everything. Father, I pray that this season here in the United States would be sweet, that you would protect them, that they would walk out encouraged and revitalized and excited about the work that you're doing in and through them in Thailand. Lord, I pray for their visas. I pray for your provision, God, that that you would make that possible for them to be able to go back in a timely manner back to Thailand. And Lord, that God, that you would use them to extend the gospel into unreached places all over Thailand and Southeast Asia. For your name and for your glory, we pray. Amen.
So here's Noah's letter to you. Dear friends, my name is Noah C. When I come to Johnny and Friends, I am at home with my people, and you make it that way. Thank you. Love, Noah.
All my life I've been carried by grace. Don't ask me how, cause I can't explain. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I've got some blessings that I don't deserve. I've got some scars, but that's how you learn. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I think it over and it doesn't add up. I know it comes from above. I've got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Yeah, miracles on miracles, count your miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4, I can't even count them all. Steady, so I won't give. You open doors that nobody could shut. I hope I never get over what you've done. I wanna live with an open heart. I wanna live like I know who you are.
Good morning. My name is Tanya, and I am the director of the Keystone and 3418 Ministries. Last week, I had the privilege of taking a team of Chapelgate volunteers to serve families affected by disability. As you saw in the photos, it was an amazing week, and although we were there to serve them, we were given so much more than we gave. I am sure that anyone wearing this t-shirt this morning would be more than happy to talk to you about it. I'm going to pray for us, and at the end, I invite you all to pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are blessed to worship together this morning. You are our Creator, our Savior, and our closest friend. You redeem impossible situations and restore shattered relationships, and we are so grateful. You are unfailing in how you care for us and steadfast in how you love us. You are gracious and merciful in how you treat us. You are the perfect Father, and we adore you. Many here today, Father, have come with heavy hearts or anxious thoughts. Some are consumed with fear, and others feel an intense sadness. Father, even though we know in our minds that we can trust you in all circumstances, we struggle in our hearts to put our trust in you completely. Forgive us in our hesitancy. Instill, fill us with unwavering confidence in your promises. Even when our difficult circumstances seem unending, help us to feel certain that you are working good in our lives. Whether it is a problem that has not been resolved or a relationship that has not been reconciled, give us the strength to wait on you. Make our hearts patient and give us attitudes of expectancy. When we worry, fill us with a humble understanding that you are all-knowing and that your will and timing are best. Today, as we confess these weaknesses, bring us to a place where our hope is in you alone. Father, thank you for pouring out your unchanging love on us, even though we are undeserving. We sin against you in what we say and what we do, as well as in our hearts and thoughts, and yet you remain faithful. We know what is right, but we do what is wrong, but still you claim us as your own. We ignore your word repeatedly, and yet you answer our cries with compassion. We run to you with our needs and fail to acknowledge you when we receive your blessings and you still offer us mercy. We are flawed and you call us your beloved. Father, thank you for giving us in ways that are limitless. As we go into this week, Father, help us to rely on your word for wisdom and encouragement because it will sustain us. And when the world is telling us lies, it will speak truth. And when we long for joy in our suffering and calm in our storms, it will reassure us. You are the source of rest and peace when we are alone or uncertain. And we are thankful that your word offers us a beautiful invitation to have a relationship with you. And as your children, we can lay down our pain that we carry and be released from the mistakes that we have made. And we praise you for this freedom that is found only in you. Father, we ask that as we worship here today, we grow in your word and rest in your presence as Mike brings us the message. In your precious name, amen. Pray with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us again?
Praise the Father, praise.
give us this time to worship you each week. And each week we come to you with grateful hearts, knowing that we can come to you each week, lifting our hearts and knowing that you receive us and that you love us. We're so thankful for that. Now as we look forward to Mike bringing us the gospel, God, give us ears and hearts to hear that with. And we pray this all in your name. Amen.
Morning, everyone. My name is Jared Dean, and I'm currently under care of Presbytery and a candidate for ministry here at Chapelgate. So today's sermon passage is Galatians 5, verses 1, and then 13 to 15. So here's verse 1. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. And then verse 13. For you were called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. This is the word of God.
Oh, wait a minute. And Jared is also a graduate of Metro Baltimore Seminary. Isn't that wonderful? Okay, no. Pray with me. Lord God, we praise your name. The worship has been so sweet, and we can only imagine that you have delighted in the praises of your people, even indwelled them. And now, God, we pray that the same Spirit who moved in our singing would speak to our hearts, that you would teach us the gospel in spite of the one who delivers the message and all the sins and failings that go with them, that we may hear your voice. Through Jesus, in whose name we pray, amen. I don't know if you're friends with one of our members, John Hoddle, on Facebook, but John is famous for posting really funny things and also really profound things. And one of the funny things he posted this past week was of a young man whose boss was in the parking lot. His boss was in the parking lot, and he was at his Lamborghini. And the young man who works for him is just blown away by the beauty of this expensive vehicle. And he goes up to his boss and tells him that. And his boss looks at him and he says, "Listen, if you take your job seriously, if you do your work faithfully, if you meet your goals consistently, then I guarantee you that next year I'll buy another one of these for myself." When he was a little boy, if we would ask our son Kevin what he wanted to be when he grew up, he would say, "I want to be a boss." The reality is that as for with our little boy son and with all of the fallen human race, we move away from servanthood. It's evidenced in Peter's repulsion to Jesus when Jesus went to wash his feet and those of his friends. It's something that's undesirable to the natural mind. This morning, I want to make one point with you and then say a few things along the way. And that is that the gospel teaches that servants change the world. The gospel teaches that servants change the world. I can't think of a better example than what we just heard from Dan of those two people in Thailand who would take these backpacks and walk from village to village, spending a day each time doing it, sleeping outdoors in order to introduce them to Jesus. Listen, servants change the world, and we see this throughout all of life, whether it's marriages, neighborhoods, offices, friendships, even churches. Why do you think Boris Johnson is being forced out in England as the prime minister? Here he is, supposed to be a public servant. We see it all the time in politics. And yet he doesn't live by the things that he tells his people to do. He lies consistently. And when he says you should stay home because of COVID, he's out partying with the elite. Servants are the ones who change the world. Albert Schweitzer once said, "I don't know what your destiny will be, but one thing I do know The only ones among you who will be really happy are those who have sought and found out how to serve. Last week, Rob, in just this wonderful message, introduced us to a term called defensive eating. And he was talking about a group that was studied in the starvation experiment that was done, and how towards the end of the experiment, they became very defensive with food that nobody else was threatening to get because they were so hungry. And as he said that, I thought of Steve Brown's story of heaven and hell and a dream that someone had about it, and of how they went to hell in this dream and they saw this banquet table that was exquisitely set with the finest china and the most beautiful stemware, and a feast that was sufficient for them to feed for all eternity. But the problem was that their utensils were so long that their arms could not possibly extend enough to feed themselves with it. And their hell was their inability to enjoy this feast that was set before them forever. But then the dreamer is taken to a vision of heaven where the exact same scene is there, this beautiful table with this exquisite china and beautiful stemware and a magnificent feast set that is enough to feed everybody for eternity. And when it comes time to eat, instead of being frustrated, each person takes their implement and feeds the person in front of them. Jesus lived in a time, he was born and lived in an oppressive time in the life of the people of Israel. He was born and raised during the time of the Roman Empire. And Jews were divided in their responses to such repression. They knew that they should be free. They knew that they were this chosen people that God had put into exile because of their continued sin, and they lived under the oppression of Rome. And they had varying reactions and responses to it. There were some who believed that political hostility was the only way, that anarchy and overthrow were the way to freedom. There were some who believed that freedom was found through religious strong-arming and legalism. And there were some who merely despaired and withdrew. But Jesus, by his own testimony, came not to be served, but to serve. Jesus took the posture of a servant. And by taking the low place, he gained access into the lives of the powerful and the lowly, the hard-hearted, the unbelieving, the religious, the morally compromised, and the despairing. Because servants change the world. Servants always live where somebody else already is. They aren't the ones that set the terms. They're the ones that go where the terms are set for them. The Lord and Savior of the universe did this. So here's what we learn in these verses that Jared just read. First of all, in verse 1, servanthood is the labor of the liberated. Servanthood is the labor of the liberated. Paul says, for freedom, Christ has set us free. And he goes on to say, and do not submit to a yoke of slavery. Peter says basically the same thing in 1 Peter 2:16, but he adds something. He says, live as people that are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. And Paul reiterates this in verse 13, warning against using our freedom in Christ as an opportunity to satisfy our sinful fleshly desires that we had before we even knew Jesus. And that word that he uses for serve, he uses interchangeably with slavery. But the key word is that word opportunity, which refers to a new base of operations. And so what Paul is saying is, if we claim to be free in Jesus, but use God's grace as a springboard for the sins that we were embedded in before we met him, then that's not freedom, that's slavery. We're still slaves to that sin. Martin Luther, in his great work, The Bondage of the Will, said, free will without God's grace is not free at all, but it is a permanent prisoner and bondslave of evil. When God empowers us to move past the idea of having to serve to serving because we are loved, we are free. and we display something more beautiful than doing something for the sake of getting praise or being accepted or being adored in return. Jesus teaches that when we serve, it isn't so much the person who is the beneficiary of our servanthood, but it's Jesus himself. When we serve others in his name, we are serving him. So servanthood is the labor of the liberated. And secondly, in verses 13 and 14, servanthood is the harvest of the beloved. Through love, serve one another. We can serve as God's people because we are loved. We can serve without sacrificing our dignity, even though it may be trampled by others at times, because we are God's beloved in Jesus. And all of these one another's that we're looking at this summer flow out of this, that we are the recipients of God's love. We are God's beloved. And therefore, we could treat others as we would have them treat us, even if they don't treat us that way, because we serve the one who loves us. We serve out of a love that we have received from God, believing that all the recognition that we will ever need, we have in Jesus, held strong in God's steadfast love. Because the alternative, according to verse 15, Paul, is ecclesiastical cannibalism. We consume one another. And he uses language that described abuse in the Hellenist culture of his day. Servanthood is so unnatural that it has to be an act of the will that is enabled by God's Spirit. How do we protect the church from being overtaken by the monsters of self-interest? We all have it, and jealousy, we all experience it, and divisiveness? By serving one another out of our new base of operation. And that is God's love. Listen, sometimes you have to will yourself to serve someone in order to not detest them. Sometimes you have to will yourself to serve someone in order to not just drown in jealousy of them. And that's how the church protects against cannibalizing itself. I could tell you, if you are not serving someone, whether at home or in the office or the neighborhood or the church, then there is a joy that is missing in your life that can't be found in any other way. Did you see the joy on the faces in the video that we just saw? I mean, there was nobody there that was like, oh boy, I have to go help these people for a week or whatever. No, there was nothing but joy because they were serving, and the God who loves them was giving them that joy. So if you are willing to serve, then there is no door that cannot be open to you, including those with your dearest relationships. It is an opus into lives and hearts, into sorrows and stories, into needs. Servants change the world. It is a captive girl in a foreign land who tells her mistress that her husband, who has leprosy, can be healed by going to Elisha the prophet in Israel, and he does. It is the human trafficked Joseph, who is a slave and a prisoner in a foreign land, who interprets the dreams of the Pharaoh and saves two nations from famine. It is the Hebrew exile Esther who makes a daring appeal that you just didn't make back then to her king, who took her as wife, even though she was in another land, and saved the Jewish race as a result of her appeal. It is Nehemiah, the cupbearer to the king in a foreign country, whose service to the foreign king led to that king allowing him to go and oversee the rebuilding of the wall in Jerusalem. Servants change the world. They're everywhere. Everybody wants to know what they can do through the people that are there that don't have an agenda for them. And listen, it doesn't come naturally. It has to be intentional. It begins with the simple prayer, Lord, use me, which is an acknowledgement that our lives are truly about serving the one who saved us. It's an admission that, like Kevin said of himself, and all of us would say of ourselves, we really want to be the boss. We want to do things on our own terms. Initially and throughout our lives, we are called to offer our hearts in obedient trust and daily surrender if we are truly going to serve. It could be as simple as rolling your neighbor's trash can, empty trash can, up to their garage, or of a kind first response to the person that you love or know who asks you to do something rather than with your face to let them know you'll do it because you think you have to. I don't even want to know how many times I've done that with Catherine, whether it's to your wife or somebody else. It could be holding babies and rocking them in the church. It could be offering to go and get the papers that were copied by a fellow worker in the copy room of the office. Whatever it is, it isn't about serving until you're seen as great. It's about simply serving because God calls us to do this. See, there's no such thing as someone who is not a servant type in the kingdom of God. As long as you belong to God through Jesus, you are called to be a servant to others as to him. In Nehemiah 3, when Nehemiah leads Israel there, he has people build walls where their homes are in front of them. And we read this tragic little statement in verse 5, but their nobles would not stoop to serve their Lord. Nehemiah got it right. They weren't refusing to serve the people that they were in Israel with. They were refusing to serve their Lord. Recently read an article, my brother sent it to me, it was a great article, did a little more homework on it, of David Brown, who recently broke the world record as the fastest completely blind runner. He was born at 15 months old, he was diagnosed with Kawasaki disease, and by the time he was 13, he was completely blind. He lived in fear until he realized that he was fast, and this enabled him to work through his depression and suicidal thoughts. But what makes this sport work is an all but invisible seeing partner who is perfectly tethered to the runner who is blind in competition. You see, servants change the world if they can get out of the way of themselves. I can't tell you how many times that I've missed the point in this. Even when I thought I was serving, whether it was an attitude in my voice, sometimes to Catherine, or on my face, or because I tethered my agenda to the needs of the person who was asking me to serve. But hearts that serve are always first tethered to the surrendered one, Jesus. In Philippians 2, 5 through 11, you can read it later. We have one of the earliest church hymns in which we read of Jesus who submitted himself, who made himself low, who made himself a servant. In Jesus, we have a king who made himself low, submitting himself to the Father by tethering himself to sinners that he obeyed all the way to their unjust execution of him when he went to the cross. He lived, he served, and died under one reality. It wasn't that people are good. It wasn't that people would see, wow, he's really a great servant. This was his reality. This is my son with whom my pleasure, with whom I am well pleased. And this freed him to serve each as they were and where they were, to forgive his executioners, to assure a dying convict of paradise, to glorify God in his affliction. He went to the cross, a servant, he was buried a criminal, and he rose King of Kings and Savior for all who tether themselves to him in faith. What about you, friend? I mean, aren't you exhausted with the enslavements of lesser masters, success, material goods, personal wealth, revenge, pleasure, all these things that seem to satisfy in the moment, but then let you down to the bottom the next moment because you're not tethered to the one who we refer to as the suffering servant, Jesus, who came and who in his last act with his disciples before they left that room, served them the meal that we're about to have. You see, you find joy in servanthood, and in you, God changes the world, even if it's in your own house. And I have found that that's often the first place that needs to change in me. If you don't know Jesus, then he doesn't ask you to fix yourself. He doesn't ask you to do all the things that we sometimes do when someone says they need our help. He asks you to trust him, to put your rest and hope and faith in him, believing that everything that you need to belong to God has already been taken care of because he came to serve us with himself. This is the gospel. It is our good news. Amen. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you have come. Jesus, you know we wouldn't have come this way. We would have come in fanfare. We would have come, landed a helicopter on a pad and had crowds there to praise us, to remember that we created everything. But you came, and you came humbly, and we thank you. And Lord, if there are any in here who don't know you, I pray, Father, that today would be the day of their salvation as they place their faith and hope and trust in you through Jesus. And for those of us who know you, who forget who you have been to us, forgive us for every time we put out airs of greatness and fail to serve the least of these as Jesus called us to. And therefore, we fail to serve you. For we pray in your name, amen. As I said, Jesus' last act was to serve his disciples. After washing their feet and them entering into a room, he broke bread and he poured wine and he gave them himself anew. The apostle, Jesus himself said that we read in the Gospels that he broke the bread, and when he had done so, he prayed, and he said, "This is my body given for you." And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink ye all of it." The apostle Paul says that as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, so we proclaim Christ's death until he comes. So if you belong to Jesus, that is, if you have put your faith and hope and trust in him and have professed this, then you are invited to the table of Christ to partake of Jesus, believing and knowing that he has given himself for you. It's a bold act. It is acknowledging that the Son of God came and humbled himself. And not only being okay with that, but believing that the only way Jesus could have gotten to you was through your brokenness and your sin, by dying for your sins. And if you have confessed this, then you are called to come with your weariness, with your failures, with your doubts, with your sins, with your struggles, and to do so boldly. And if you don't know Jesus, then don't take yet. Wait until he liberates you by, in his grace, giving you the assurance that he has come to make you free.
Go to God and confess our sins. So join with me as we pray. We believe that Jesus came to save his people from their sins, and we count ourselves among those people. We confess our lack of love, our selfish thoughts, our unkind words. Father, forgive us and rescue us through Jesus. Let us experience your presence as Emmanuel, God with us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
After breaking the bread, Jesus said, "Take, eat." Let's partake. Thank you, Jesus, that you have come, for your sacrifice that wasn't theoretical, but was flesh and blood, yours. We praise you. Amen. And in the same way, Jesus took the cup and said, "Drink ye all of it." For your shed blood and the forgiveness of sins, we praise you, Jesus, that you would out of such love come that we may be free and forgiven. We give you all the glory, for we pray in your name. Amen.
Would you all stand and sing with us one more time?
Glory.
I was thinking as we were singing, I planned on saying something else at the end, but I was thinking that in my flesh, who would I have come as or like if I had the power to do that? And I thought it would be all the heroes I grew up with. Early in life, the Lone Ranger. I would have ridden in silver, ridden off, and, you know, hi-oh, silver away. And then it was Batman and the Batmobile. Then it was Spider-Man with the webs. Then I would phase in like someone like Captain Kirk or something like that. And then maybe as an old pastor, I would enter in as Tim Keller or something like that. But you know, that's not who God wants. We sometimes don't serve because we think we can't be what we think we should have been or dwell on what we're not. The person that God wants in me to serve is me and you. And that means that because of Jesus, for you, there's a place. And that's a beautiful place. Whether you're worshiping with us online, for which we're thankful, or in person, for which we're thankful, we pray that Christ has met you where you are, both in the good stuff and in the not so good stuff, and that he has said something to your heart that has a whiff of resurrection. And that you will go into the week knowing that you are loved in him. Call us if you need a thing. We're as close as your phone. Thank you for your generosity. We pray that that continues. For those of you online who may belong to another church, we hope you'll keep going, giving to that church. And we really mean that. And we thank you for your participation. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, even Christ Jesus, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. May you go in his peace, because he has come as a servant. He has died as a criminal. He has risen as King of Kings for you. Amen. God bless you.